Dr. B. Raju from Usmania. I think three, Ravinder Rao sir, Jeevan Rao sir, Raju are there, sir. Okay, sir, Hota sir?
Yeah, yeah.
Sir, this is your session, sir. We'll take leave, sir.
Okay. Okay, thank you, everyone. Good morning, everybody. Today, this is a very unusual, you know, conference, TSSCon online we are conducting, but it is going well, very well since morning.
Hello, Hota sir.
Yes, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, sir.
Sir, good morning.
Good morning.
Morning, sir. How are you, sir?
Raju, good morning.
Sir, good morning, sir. Ravinder Rao, sir, and Hota, sir. Good morning, sir.
Yes, sir.
Morning, sir. Hota, sir.
Okay.
Raju.
Nihar, you are here? Hi, morning, sir.
Morning, sir.
Nihar, you are here?
Yes, sir. Am I audible?
Yeah, yeah. Okay, it's fine. Let me continue. Go out of this. Hello.
Yes.
Hello, Nihar.
Yes.
Hello, Nihar. Okay. Hello.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, sir. I'm yes. Starting, sir. Okay. Good morning, everybody. Today our symposium is on diabetic foot. Diabetic foot. As we'll touch only on the management part with three speakers. As you know, the principles of this infection, glycemic control, debridement, and moist wound healing, followed by offloading and treatment of associated ischemia like devascularization of lower limb. So under these three broad headings, three speakers will deal. First speaker will be Dr. Srinivas. He's a senior podiatric surgeon from Apollo Hospital, Hyderabad. He has got a lot of interest in podiatric surgery, particularly in diabetic foot. And you'll speak on surgeon and the diabetic foot disease, followed by I'll speak on offloading the diabetic foot need of the hour. And third speaker will be Dr. Nihar Ranjan Pradhan. He's a senior consultant and HOD, Department of Vascular and Endovascular Surgery, Apollo Hospital, Jubilee Hills, Hyderabad. He'll speak on diagnosis and revascular procedures for peripheral arterial disease in diabetic foot. Can I request Dr. Srinivas to have his first lecture on surgeon and the diabetic foot disease?
Yes, sir. Thank you for those kind words of introduction. Diabetic foot, as we know, is a very common day-to-day surgical practice patient who comes into all our surgical clinics. When the word diabetic foot, when we hear, we normally think of a necrosed or a cellulitic foot that you could see. But actually, if you look, it is a myriad of presentations like you could see here, ranging from trophic ulcers to complex ischemic ischemic wounds to simple ischemic wounds to wounds with a lot of infection, necrosis, biofilm, and whatnot. So I think day to day in our surgical practice, we do come across this myriad of presentations. And as surgeons, we have been trained traditionally, the minute we hear diabetic foot, either a debridement has to be done or an amputation has to be done. Usually it's an emergency. Most likely patients may have poor outcomes because of diabetes, uncontrolled diabetes, comorbidities, coronary artery disease. And a lot of times we also do think traditionally whether we should refer the patient to your professional enemies. So my job today, speaking on role of the surgeon in the management of diabetic foot disease, is to start making you realize that you need to start thinking outside the box. I carry greetings from my alma mater, Apollo Hospitals, now for 10 years. And I lead the podiatry or the diabetic foot service in this hospital. Nihar is closely associated because we are dependent specialties. Now, I will not talk much on diabetes. All of us know that polyneuropathy is there, diabetic sensory neuropathy is there, autonomic neuropathy is there, motor neuropathy is there, that leads to deformity in the foot that leads to ulceration. And on the other extreme, you have a neuroischemia wherein you have poor blood supply, microcirculation, poor macrocirculation. So these deformities, my talk will probably focus only on the left half, which is the neuropathic and the infected diabetic foot. Not to forget an acutely swollen red warm foot, which is most likely acute Charcot foot, which should always be borne in mind when you deal with an acutely warm, hot, red, swollen foot. Now, going ahead, All of us know that developing a foot ulcer is very common in diabetics, and the presence of a long-standing foot ulcer can lead to infection, it can lead to hospitalization, it can lead to 55 times more hospitalization risk, it can lead to multi-drug resistant organisms. It leads to probably, it has a very high risk of an amputation when infection sets in, and there's a lot of cost burden. What I would like to draw your attention is majority of these lower extremity amputations are in patients with diabetes are preceded by the stage of the ulcer there are. And today we even realize there is a pre-ulcer stage wherein the patient comes with trophic changes, callosity, skin changes, pre-ulcerative changes. If you catch them right at that point of time, probably this pathway to amputation can be cut off early on. And these folks are pretty sick folks. You can see the presence of a neuropathic ulcer itself has a high 5-year mortality rate. And if there is ischemic ulcer or peripheral arterial disease, the mortality or 5-year mortality of these patients seems to be very, very high. These guys are very sick. So we need to do minimum intervention and as early as possible before they get going into septic or infective complication. There is a very tremendous cost burden, both for the patient and for the society. These are mostly in dollars. This is a borrowed slide from one of the international speakers. Anyway, for us, the patient has to pay from the pocket many a time. These multiple interventions and these preventive measures work out much, much cheaper than amputations. The minute you see a foot ulcer in a diabetic, it's time to, it is the beginning of the end. So you need to realize that these guys are very, very sick. Unlike the other regular surgical practice patients like an acute appendix or an acute or a gallstone disease where, now again, the stress is on the third point, a majority of lower extremity amputation preceded by the stage of the ulcer. Intervene at the ulcer or even better if you can intervene before the ulcer forms or a pre-ulcerative lesions. What are all diabetics at risk? Well, the answer is no. There are certain risk factors for people with diabetes to develop the foot ulcers, uncontrolled diabetes. Longer the duration, the higher the incidence of the neuropathy. Vascular disease, when it intervenes, it makes the prognosis. Patients, if they have diabetic retinopathy or elderly with cataract or visual loss or blindness, they can harm themselves. So self-protective mechanisms are not there. Now moving on, when you see a diabetic foot patient, you need to probably identify them early, assess why is that callus forming, why is that high pressure under the foot forming, which Dr. Professor Hota is going to tell us in the next lecture. Can we do something surgically as a surgeon to actually heal these ulcers, other than giving them the contact cast, other than giving them the shoes, is what I would want to lay my focus on. You have areas of high pressure on the left-hand side. Patient continues to walk because they don't have the pain because of the peripheral neuropathy. The ulcer forms. The ulcer becomes infected, necrotic. A part of the foot is removed and the ulcer recurs. So we also need to be thinking about ulcer, prevent the recurrence when we manage diabetic foot. 6 tenets of management of diabetic foot disease: mechanical control or offloading, which Dr. Hota will tell us, wound control, which include the complicated or the advanced, include the wound dressings, what all you put on the wound, infection control, the antibiotics, the local antibiotics, vascular control, what Nihar is going to say in dysvascular foot, taking care of their diabetes, their smoking, their metabolic issues, educating the patient of peripheral neuropathy. They have insensate foot, they need to care for it on a daily basis. If there is sufficient arterial inflow, if the infection is managed properly, and if the pressure is relieved, all diabetic foot ulcers will heal. What is the time you would want to give them? The time you would want to give them is roughly 4 weeks. In 4 weeks, if the ulcer shrinks by about half the size, or roughly about 10 to 15% reduction, meaningful wound size reduction of about 10 to 15% per week or 50% in 4 weeks, you are in the right track. Continue what you're doing. Now, many a time after 2 weeks of a hallux amputation and removal of the metatarsal, you can see after 2 weeks, a lot of infection on the left-hand side. You always have the question as a surgeon, is a higher amputation or is it going to be salvaged? We'll see the story how we salvaged it a little later. So stressing on to the role of the surgeon, surgical interventions to curative and prophylactic surgeries to heal the ulcers, examples of which we're going to see shortly through clinical cases. Always think about prevention of the recurrence. Take preventive measures right at the pre-ulcer or the callus level and give ulcer or wound care. Now, classifying diabetic foot surgery, does it make sense? Yes. We can classify surgical intervention in the diabetic foot as emergency or urgent surgeries, which limit the progression of infection, curative surgeries, which aid to help an open ulcer to heal, prophylactic surgeries, there is no open ulcer, but there is pre-ulcer stage where you correct the biomechanics and get them to heal, elective surgeries where there is no neuropathy, but the patient has a deformity, you would want to correct the deformity like the bunion or the hammer toe so that it doesn't create problem. So class 4 or emergency, most commonly practiced. Very few of us do those prophylactic curative procedures. This basically involves some kind of amputation or removal of part of the foot or of fasciitis. You can see the patient had a chronic trophic ulcer, started with a callus. If we had intervened at that point of time, this situation of getting into this infection wouldn't have happened. Here, the second toe has a wet gangrene, gash shadows of the infection seen on the X-ray, though obvious osteomyelitis is not seen. A thorough debridement was done, patient wasn't settling, a second toe amputation was done. And at this point of time also, we need to continue following these patients, unlike your lat coli patients or unlike your hernia repair patients. These patients are chronic illnesses, like your cancer patients, need to be frequently seen in the hospital. Necrotizing fasciitis, a fasciotomy is not sufficient. A fasciectomy is the answer, i.e. removal of the necrosed fascia as sheets. That how do you control forest fire? The same way we need to control necrotizing fasciitis. This is a patient, same patient who went on after a fasciectomy, went for a couple of days of hyperbaric therapy, and you can see the wound granulating, ready for a skin graft. An 80-year-old man with a bunion, if you treated the bunion as an elective procedure, would not have landed up with this. He had significant vascular disease right from the femoral down. He would have warranted an above knee amputation because the distal flow was so bad that it couldn't be improved. We did a 4-foot amputation or a transmetatarsal amputation. You can see the stump got infected with hyperbaric oxygen for a long time. When do you use this advanced modality? I have a slide on that too. And finally, after long sessions of hyperbaric therapy, we were able to heal this 80-year-old man who would have otherwise lost his limb above the knee. Patient with the 4th toe gangrene, 4th toe amputated when the patient came in with wet gangrene, then vascularity was involved. The intervention of surgeon in an ischemic foot, when you know there is no vascularity, do a limited resection like the 4th toe here, then do the vascular intervention in terms of the angioplasty in this patient, anterior tibial angioplasty, because his wound was largely occupied in the angiosome of the anterior tibial artery. Great toe gangrene, again, the callus was missed, the ulcer was missed, came in necrosis, first toe was amputated. You can see the last bottom figure, in spite of the first toe being amputated, there is a tenosynovitis. You should remember diabetic foot is a tenosynovitis or a tendon spreading infection going along the flexor tendon onto the flexor tunnel and ascending up the ankle. So finally, what had to be done was a transmetatarsal amputation, use of negative pressure therapy, and covered by a skin graft. So this is what I was trying to stress on, an early conservative amputation, which include conservative. Why conservative? Because why an amputation? Part of the foot is removed. Why conservative? Because a part of the foot is going to be conserved. You can still, so this classifies as a limb salvage. You're still going to save the limb. The entire plantar space which need plantar compartment affected has to be accessed. You'll see that in a minute. All devitalized tissue to be removed at the first attempt. The affected tendon should be traced to the proximal extent where it is healthy and excised off, and the use of a posterior plantar slab for a support or for offloading also is a very helpful tool in after most. So this is central plantar space. Zone 2 is the central plantar space. Toes 2 to 4 behave as a single unit. The toe, first great toe behaves separate, and the lateral or the fifth toe behaves in a separate way. These are the compartments that you need to realize. You also will need have a dorsal compartment as well as the intertransmetatarsal. I don't know if my cursor can be seen on your screen. Along the metatarsal shaft, there's transverse lymphatics which carry the infection. That compartment also needs to be known. There is an iceberg phenomenon. We heard the previous speaker also speak about multisternal goiter the same way, substernal goiter the same way. What looks clinically is the left. You have a lot of, ultimately when you finish, come to viable tissue, you see how much of tissue is gone. First toe, second toe, patient presented after medial two toes being removed after 2 weeks with a pointing pus in the midplantar abscess. The reason was the tenosynovitis, the flexor tendon that I mentioned. Plantar flexor tendons of all the 5 toes, they go towards the flexor tunnel where the other incision is given. You need to trace that frank infection you need to trace that tendon sheath and excise and remove that infected tendon. Only then this will go to achieve complete healing. Tendon is your enemy in the diabetic foot. You need to trace and excise that infected tendon in the plantar flexure till you get the healthy tendon. Most of these surgeries in acute infection can be done with local anesthesia. Osteomyelitis patient of the calcaneum abscess drain 10 days not healing. When you do an x-ray, you see calcaneal osteomyelitis. All that you need to do is go and curate this bone out, completely offload this patient, it goes to complete healing. Newly detected elderly diabetic, frank gangrene, second toe ray amputation was done. After the ray amputation, two other toes, so the patient becomes fussy that why came with one black toe, the surgeon gave two black toes. This is the time. So when you do that initial second toe, you have time for the patient's sugars to get controlled, kidney injury to get in control, so that your angiogram and your nephrotoxic things can be taken care of. Refer to the vascular surgeon, bypass done, and a final answer, which the patient can walk on his own limb, a 4-foot amputation. Again, this elderly lady, she was a matron, nursing matron, that callus in the heel was missed and she came with frank infection, which had to be put on negative pressure after thorough debridement closed with a skin graft. Now coming to those ulcer healing procedures, the only difference between the class 3 curative and the class 2 prophylactic is that the class 2 is done when there's no ulcer but only a callus. The class 3 is done to aid the healing rate of an open wound. So a ball of the big toe is the commonest area. Here in this patient, he had a bilateral ball of big toe ulcer. The metatarsal Keller arthroplasty was done only on the left side. You can see that he had gone to complete healing within 6 weeks. This elderly lady, diabetic, middle-aged lady, came with the recurrent ulcer for 11 years. All that we needed to do is go and remove that area of the pressure because she failed using the shoes, she failed using the contact cast. So two incisions on the metatarsal, just excise the metatarsal head, the pan metatarsal head excision as it is called. You can see that the ulcer goes on to complete healing. Similarly, addressing the Achilles tendon pathology because there is a structural and a functional Achilles tendon pathology as part of the diabetic neuropathy. That can be addressed by a percutaneous tendo-Achilles lengthening, giving 3 stabs in the tendo-Achilles, very similar to the anal fissure submucous pinctrotomy that we do with the 15 number and the feel of that knife and the give way of the pressure. And you can see that this is an outpatient procedure. You can see it goes to complete healing. This patient had the claw toes, the interphalangeal joints had to be excised, K-wire passed, and you can see complete healing. This patient had a subtrophic ulcer because of the second metatarsal head. The metatarsal head had got osteomyelitic, subluxated. All that you do see on the right second top, right top figure is a small incision. That metatarsal head, which is causing the pressure, is being excised. Metatarsal head being excised, and it led to complete healing. Now, a patient with a normal x-ray, non-healing wound, but a chronic ulcer, bone scan proved uptake, early osteomyelitis, treated with tendo-Achilles lengthening and a debridement, complete healing. So class 2 and class 3 are very similar, like I told, the only difference being presence of an ulcer or presence of the pre-ulcerative skin. So this patient was skin grafted. He presented with a midfoot non-healing wound. You can see that the midfoot has completely collapsed. He had to be debrided, and then a surgeon previously treating had put a skin graft, but it recurred because the pressure wasn't addressed. This is the lateral view of the same patient. You can see that cone of bone, this cone of bone needs to be excised in the midfoot. It's called a midfoot exostectomy. You can go through the medial or the lateral, here in this case lateral, and before your stitches heal, you can see the ulcer heals. So pressure relief, unless you give the pressure relief, it does not heal. Elective procedures in this patient, the first toe, you can see so much of deformity in the first toe, which was corrected by an IP joint fusion, interphalangeal joint fusion of the first toe. You can see that after 2 months, even the callosities and the ulcers have healed because the pressures have reduced. Class 1 elective procedures are done only in patients who have the deformities, but not even the pre-ulcerative signs. That is like correction of the bunion, the hamartoma, or the bony spurs. The 5 P's are saving these diabetic limbs are podiatric care, giving them the right kind of footwear, reducing the pressure, very rarely prophylactic or curative surgeries like we saw a few examples on, educating the patients that the neuropathy is not going away, they need to be seeing the surgeon, they need to be on the right kind of footwear lifelong. So talking about prevention, an ounce of prevention is definitely, this is the commonest presentation. We see them with hypertrophic, hyperkeratotic areas in the plantar surface, which are areas of high pressure. Shape the callus and give a moist pressing, it should heal off. So this is the chain we are trying to bake from the callus to the ulcer. Patient continues to walk, failure to heal, gets infected, part of the foot amputated, and then the pressures still continue to remain high. All that you need is a little common sense. And what I would like to impress on by towards the end of my lecture here would be that certain things like, you know, the nerve decompression decompressing the peripheral nerves at the tarsal tunnel or the dorsum, anterior tibial nerve at the dorsum, correcting the vascular disease, correcting the joint mobility or the deformities can heal these ulcers before they get infected. And then it's much easier for the surgeon to treat these than to treat those acute infected wounds. If you miss those, they come out with the spark like this. And the ADA or the American Diabetes Association has a 3-minute examination which says, ask the patient for a few things, signs, symptoms of peripheral neuropathy, signs, symptoms of vascular disease, previous ulcer. What do you look at? You look at these things. If any of these things, deformity, callus, previous amputation, previous ulcer, vascular insufficiency, if any of these are there, they are to be categorized. So these are examples, collapsed midfoot on the bottom, high arched foot, crowded toes, a red hot swollen foot, or an acute Charcot foot. And this is a typical patient, previous amputation, acute ulcer, acute infection, clawing of the toes, callus, trophic ulcer. These patients, high-risk patients, you need to probably be seeing on a regular basis. The post-op thing after tendo-axial is lengthening was done. So the minute you see this diabetic foot, you need to active infection, active acute Charcot foot, high-risk, they come under the active group. The rest are categorized based on the level of their risk, and then they are screened onto your hospital. Screened onto your protocol as per the risk they fall to. A good wound care, debride the non-viable tissue, give a moist wound environment, offload them, give topical care. In 4 weeks, like I said, if they shrink to half the size, you're on the right job. If they're not shrinking to half the size in 4 weeks, you need to probably advance your thing. And what are your options? Then you need to think of, if they have already failed the standard of care or good wound care, then you need to think of using negative pressure, using hyperbaric, using growth factors, using these curative or prophylactic surgeries. Many a time you need to couple technologies. This patient had a 4-foot amputation for a sepsis, poor granulation after 2 to 3 weeks time. You put them onto negative pressure, you can see that the granulation goes improving, ready to get a close. All that is black need not be a necrosis, need not be a gangrene. This patient had actually used some Ayurvedic counter-written medication, herbal medication, which discolored the skin, underlying tissue was normal, the vascularity was normal, debrided, skin grafted later, and you can see a good function at even 6 years follow-up. So this is a patient that we saw on slide one, amputation versus salvage. First toe, very bad, dorsum abscess, debrided, first toe ray was removed, including the metatarsal. After 2 weeks, you see that a lot of bioburden still seen in the last picture. Treat them with negative pressure, VAC therapy, later on at this stage, plated growth factors and the use of dermis, which is a artificial scaffold again. A scooter silencer burn, bike silencer burn injury, sloughing of the tendo-axial is debrided, later on put to about a short course. Most of these necrotic infections, they respond well to a short course, 7 to 10, by short I mean 7 to 10 days of hyperbaric therapy, and then later on a thin split skin graft was applied. One needs to think after months of the first figure, after months of this one, conservative care, you manage getting that wound to heal. But as the patient started to walk, the mechanics was wrong. So you need to consider the mechanics also before. The last patient, 4-foot amputation healed, but again, the lateral aspect is going bound to get. So you need to think about biomechanics also when you treat this diabetic foot. So I think I will end the cases here because I've run out of time. This patient, again, the last one, the latest thing we are using is the artificial skin dermal substitute called the Integra. Medial ankle abscess, medial after debridement, you can see the ankle joint is exposed, and then you apply this artificial dermis, how it is applied, and then after application, it goes to complete healing. Particularly avascular structure like ligament, tendon, or bone exposed in an otherwise healthy wound, you can use this biological alternate tissues to heal. This is the latest thing that when the patient comes too late, probably it is difficult to even sometimes save the life of the patient. Recurrence prevention, educating the patient is most important, accommodating the deformity in the right kind of shoes, and recognizing why is the recurrence happening. Most likely it is a biomechanical defect which needs to be corrected. So again, I think an elderly lady, bilateral amputee, see how energetic she is versus a 55-year-old Bologna amputee. So it is not the age, it is the attitude. And this is what you need to regularly teach your patients. All this is freely available diabetic foot care you can Google. And it is always a team effort. You need multiple specialties to come together to achieve the limb salvage and maintaining the limbs for a long time. So again, the same slide, identify them early pre-ulcerative stage, give them offloading, do not heal, offer the advanced therapy options or the prophylactic curative surgeries, and then you can prevent recurrence too. And managing diabetic foot disease in the pandemic, we have national as well as international IWGDF, International Working Group on the Diabetic Foot Guidelines, how to manage diabetic foot disease during the pandemic. I'd like to thank you for a patient listening.
Thank you very much, Dr. Srinivas.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Okay, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Now, Dr. Srinivas has given an excellent talk on the role of a surgeon as per the diabetic foot is concerned. I will touch a particular scenario, that is your offloading the diabetic foot. Now, as per the principles already I have told you, what is our aim? Our aim is to ensure the early wound healing and to prevent amputation, particularly major ones, to save the limb. So, for that reason, offloading is one of the important factors, because once a diabetic foot ulcer forms, healing is delayed. And if the area is not effectively offloaded, then there will be problem. Now, offloading is a key factor in the diabetic foot, is that the dynamic pressures are higher than in those without diabetes. So our main aim is to relieve that dynamic pressure. So causes of the increases in the dynamic pressures are bony deformity, retraction of the toes, pes cavus, lack of soft tissue cushioning, and callus formation. Now, the concepts of the offloading are two types. Now, once we are getting the more force on the foot, which we want to remove that force, how we are going to do that? By doing some sort of mechanical protection. Now, this mechanical protection we have to achieve for achieving that wound healing. So how we are going to achieve that mechanical protection? That is by two means. One is onwetting. Onwetting the foot means we should not give any wet on the foot or wound. And second is offloading. That is rebalancing the weight on the foot or leg with the patient still weight bearing. So this second option of offloading is better, because it is not practicable on our patient to say all the time, you could say that don't put any weight on your foot, that is not practicable. Now, the aim of the offloading is that, as I have told you earlier, it is to redistribute the plantar pressures so that there will be a resultant reduction in the foot pressures, shock and shear force. Now, with this aim, our objective should be to offload or reduce the pressure at the ulcer while keeping the patient ambulatory. This is very important. Patient has got ulcer, we are treating the patient, but we are not asking the patient to remain bedbound. Okay, once it is ambulatory, he feels quite comfortable. So what are the ideal characteristics of offloading? First of all, it should provide effective pressure reduction from the ulcer at all times. It should have wide application to all patients. It should have caused no side effects or secondary lesion, should be easily applied, and patient compliance, which is very, very important as per offloading is concerned, and it should be cost effective, particularly when you think our country, where the, you know, so to say, third world country or developing country, whatever you may say, cost effective, that is one of the important factor. Now, what are the different strategies? First one, as Dr. Srinivas has told, it is a callus debridement. Callus is one of the main precursors to ulcer formation. Hence, our effective callus prevention and debridement of the callus, as and when required, is vital in reducing the ulcer formation. Now, next are the accommodative padding. The padding is applied here to the entire plantar surface of the foot with an aperture around the wound so that we can do the dressings. But thing is, the disadvantage is that in presence of edema, this aperture around the wound can amplify the swelling and concentrate it around the wound. So it is not usually practicable. We don't prefer it. There are so many temporary post-op shoes like this, the temporary post-operative, you know, shoes, as you are seeing on this screen. This is a half shoe type. These are the short-term types of footwear which have got a rigid sole, and they are used to cover the plaster cast to protect the dressings after foot surgery. These are the half shoes. Half shoes are advantageous in the sense they are easy to apply, inexpensive, and removable. But the disadvantage is that it has got a decreased efficacy and the gait is always unstable. Next is your total contact height. This is the best, this is the gold standard which all of us were, I think, were using. This is the most common modality for offloading. This modality when it is used because it is well molded, it is minimally padded cast that maintains the construction of the entire plantar aspect of the foot and to elevate the lower leg. Now, this TCC, when you apply, it reduces the pressure at the site of ulceration by 84% to 92%, with healing rates ranging from 72% to 100% over a course of 5 to 7 weeks. So total contact cast is the gold standard. We should always prefer this one unless otherwise recommended. And this is the total, you know, contact cast TCC. Always we use, we know all these things. And whenever it is, you know, required, we can also, in a posterior slab, where we want to change the dressing repeatedly, we can apply a posterior slab or a back slab instead of a total contact cast. Now the advantages are, it redistributes the pressures across the foot more efficiently by offloading and shortens the healing times accordingly. Also, it protects the foot from the infection and it helps in reducing the or controlling the edema. However, it has got certain disadvantages, like it is not useful in case of healing ulcers. When the ulcers are there, it is healing. When we have to apply dressing every day, it is not possible. Number two, the most important factor is the loss of flexibility. And daily wound assessment is not practical. Hence, this is a, though it is a gold standard, but it has got certain disadvantages. Other, this contraindication, TCC cannot be applied all the time. There are certain contraindications like severe ischemia or peripheral artery disease. Draining, are the wounds in the posterior heel, which is not possible. Wounds with ischemia, infected wounds, which requires dressing all the time. Diabetic foot ulcer with osteomyelitis. These are the contraindications. Now, after TCC, what are other offloading? There are removable cast workers. Removable cast workers are usually preferred by the patients because it can be removed and applied again. There are so many manufacturers, there are so many products are available, but it has got its own advantages, it has got its own disadvantages. This is a removable cast worker. This is a typical in a crow, that is sarco-resistant orthotic worker. It is usually used as an offloading for foot ulcers, but and also unstable sarcopod or ankle. This can be used both for foot ulcers as well as sarcopod. Okay, this model provides a TCC interface, a pre-tibial shell, and a rocker bottom. This is your pre-tibial shell. This is a rocker bottom. Okay, and it serves as a TCC. But the only problem is that patient can remove at any time. Next is your air cap pneumatic worker. It is a removable semi-rigid plastic offloading device. It is just like a walker type. It reduces the peak plantar pressures to an equal or greater degree compared with TCC. Hence, it is as good as TCC. Next thing, you have this Bladesoe comforter boots. It has got an auto mode and with memory form. It has a beautiful thing, it has a memory board. As per the code, it remembers it and it acts upon that. And the advantage is that it can be removed for daily testing, whereas TCC cannot be removed, but this can be removed every day for inspection and daily. It's an advantage like if we can put the positive, but the food doesn't fit in the confines of that conformer food, this device cannot be utilized. Next is the SCOS CAS in a board. This is an alternative to POP CAS. But thing is that it has got a beautiful thing, but it has got a window. It has got a window cut at the site of ulcer. But still then it has got certain disadvantages and advantages also. Advantages are it is light in weight, it can be removed and allow for a regular inspection and wound care. Be that in double edge wood, then in the trapo, that is pressure relieving ankle foot orthosis, they are available in the market. Next is your this, what are the advantages? Advantages of this removable calcium, sir, whatever we have discussed, that easily removed for inspection of the wound. Unlike this your TCC. And easier to do activities such as bathing and sleeping. Patient can remove during bathing and sleeping. After that, he can utilize it. But the disadvantage is that the patient may not obey you. He can remove the cast at any given time. For that reason, we can apply instant total contact cast. This is a wrapping. This is a wrapping over this. This is a wrapping of fiberglass or any cohesive bandage or plaster. We can apply. And the advantage of ITCC is that it binds the benefit of offloading plus the benefit of force compliance. That means patient cannot remove it. Patient cannot remove it, but the doctor can remove it for daily inspection and this. Other preventive measures, you know, like there are so many available in the market, silicone insole, therapeutic footwear, so on and so forth. But newer methods like this, these are smart shoes. Okay, various companies that are bringing out smart shoes, and this is another, you know, smart shoes, smart socks, like that, they are coming to the market. Now, this is another interesting part I want to tell you, which you should be proud of, that one of our engineering colleges in India, in Madras, they have designed to control the high pressure areas of the, you know, foot by providing vibrations of different frequency. This is the equipment. Okay, it's an automatic thing. It is called Cortex Watch Smart Shoe. And it may come to market at any time. Then these are the whatever I have told you, conservative. But it is surgical offloading. Surgical offloading is a procedure undertaken when the intention of relieving mechanical stress from a specific region of the foot. And indication is that it is a hard to heal plantar ulcers with non-surgical offloading intervention. That means when we have tried all this non-surgical offloading intervention and still then the ulcer is still healing, the ulcer is callous to heal, that time we apply surgical offloading. There are so many procedures, there is no time to go into detail. Coplexor tenotomy, Achilles tendon release, metatarsal head resection is commonly done, osteotomy, exocetomy, commonly done, external fixation of joint arthroplasty, tissue pillars also, silicon or fat. Now, this is last year only this international working group on the diabetic foot guidelines, it has come up. Out of this 9 recent recommendations, I'll just amplify only 4, which are the most widely accepted. A non-removable knee-high offloading device is the first choice, followed by a removable knee-high and removable ankle-high offloading device as second and third choice. And next is your do not use and don't instruct the patient not to use conventional or standard, you know, foot therapy like a footwear as offloading treatment. Normal footwear, whatever we are getting in the market, they cannot be used as offloading treatment. Next is your whenever there is a non-plantar foot ulcer in a diabetic patient, always use a removable ankle high offloading device, maybe with some modification. And to conclude, ladies and gentlemen, this local wound care, infection management, revascularization, and pressure offloading are all required in the management of the diabetic foot ulcer. But offloading is the most important component because it brings a cohesive bridge among each other. All the modalities, it brings a cohesive bridge. Only the diabetic foot ulcer, as you know, it's a prelude to 84% of lower extremity amputation. Very important to remember. Hence, it is important to ensure quick healing of diabetic foot ulcer. Since neuropathy is estimated to be present in 1 to 1 in 4 diabetics and more than 80% of diabetic foot ulcers, hence judicious offloading is prime requirement of diabetic foot ulcer management. Selection of the offloading, it should be patient specific. We cannot be rigid. Next, the ulcer size should be halved in 4 weeks of treatment. If it is not, then you have to reinvestigate and assess the patient why it is not healing. Surgical offloading should be considered when the conservative offloading fails. And treatment strategies need to be progressively long-term offloading, and we must consider the surgical intervention to mechanically stabilize or harmonize. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. I have finished my talk. Now, I request Dr. Nihar to come.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yes, you are audible, sir.
So yes. So my slides are visible.
Yeah, visible.
Yeah. Thank you. Yes. So. Thanks to all the organizing committee members, including Dr. Jagdish Gowd, and also our, just now I was listening our president's message that our life is going last three phase last in 1 year. I was also remembering last year when he was our guest of honor of our national conference, Professor Raghuram. So similarly, our if I think our Professor Hota sir, last 1 month, we are planning and doing the work so that today's our session will be very good. And my special thanks to organizing committee and as well as our chairpersons, Professor Rao and all other chairpersons. So I got the opportunity to work these places like and CMC Vellore and Nizams and also St. Mary's Hospital. And today, always we are worried that for the heart attack. So what is about the leg attack? So because when we are asking any patient, are you able to walk around? Their history is, yes, I am walking around. So that history they are saying when they are roaming at the at home and they have not gone out. If we'll ask now, they'll tell, sir, because COVID, we are not going out. But what is about 6 months back? So before March, whether you are going out or no, few years, if you take history, many of our patients, they are not walking without stop during, even if in diabetic also. So by that, we'll know at least the claudication plane and claudication distance. So all we know by 2025, by WHO, is every fifth diabetic patient will be Indian and every 22nd one major amputation. So is this preventable? Thanks to my previous presenter, Dr. Srinivas, my colleague in Apollo Hospital, Jubilee Hills, and also Professor Hota. So how to prevent neuropathic ulcer and proper footwear. So regarding the coming to the vascular point of view, because so many delegates are there, so many PG students are also there. My message to them, whenever you are seeing any patient with diabetes, please follow your third year MBBS, first clinical year MBBS clinical examination. So please don't forget to check the distal pulses all over body apart from the general examination. So coming to what is peripheral arterial disease, it is atherosclerotic occlusive disease in aortoiliac or femoropopliteal or distal disease. And if you see, the male gender is more and advanced age, it slowly increases. Many people, they ask, even if non-diabetic also, why it happened to me? If you see here, if they have associated with smoking, hypertension, hyperlipidemia, and if associated with diabetes, then it is disastrous. So I used to tell them, you see, the diabetes is not going to leave you in the entire life. At least you leave tobacco and control the diabetes and control the dyslipidemia and control hypertension. So minor is homocysteinemia, obesity, hypercoagulable state, and physical inactivity. This is a, nowadays it is coming in our cigarette packet also, that smoking can cause gangrene. When I was in Nizams in 2008, one engineer came all the way from Bangalore without saying his family, that because of the gangrene of the leg. So how to tell them that, sir, four of our classmates during engineering started smoking at a time. Why I am suffering? So I used to tell them that why all of you are not established in your life. So that means with a gene, who will have cancer, who will have gangrene also. So I used to tell them, please stop tobacco completely. So pathogenesis, all we know, atherosclerotic process. In the, so when they come that I have only one toe gangrene, so my heart is fine. So many, I used to tell them that it is a generalized process. If there is atherosclerosis of the distal diseases, so definitely 70% chance you will have single or triple vessel disease like coronary artery disease. So the problem is symptomatic are the tip of iceberg. As I told already, because of the lifestyle, many people, they are not walking. So we don't know the claudication pain or claudication distance. And patient land up to us with critical limb ischemia like pain at rest or tissue loss or gangrene. That time they will tell, sir, till 4 days back I was walking around. That means at home only few steps. And when the patient develops with rest pain and gangrene, if you'll see the atrial Doppler report, they'll say that there is some thrombosis. Usually, apart from the atherosclerosis, the stagnant part of the blood vessel gets thrombosed. So it is very difficult to establish by Doppler alone. So we have to do few more investigation, I'll tell later. So if you see here how they present peripheral arterial disease. So history taking, as already I told, then physical examination, ankle brachial pressure index measurement, ABI measurement, non-invasive tests like atrial duplex, CT peripheral angio, and invasive tests like conventional angiogram. Asymptomatic, only ABI measurement will be sufficient. So any of our diabetic patients, so as a part of the evaluation, we used to, every year we used to do ABI measurement. Nowadays, good machines are available. You can see here, symptomatic is only 10%, asymptomatics are 90% of our diabetic patients of peripheral arterial disease. So this is the ankle brachial pressure index measurement. We need a small audio Doppler machine. Nowadays with few thousand, it is available. So ankle systolic blood pressure, either posterior tibial or dorsal pedis, divided by highest arm systolic blood pressure. So how to interpret? This is very important. If it is less than normal, it's supposed to be 1, less than 0.9 abnormal, and severe peripheral arterial disease when it is less than 0.5. But very limitations are there because of calcified blood vessels. Patient with diabetes, elderly age, calcified blood vessels, there it will be erroneous. It may go more than one also in spite of ischemia. So these are the investigations from the atrial Doppler, color Doppler to CT peripheral angiogram, followed by digital subtraction angiogram. So peripheral arterial disease. So now, as I told, coexisting other disease like coronary artery disease will be more than 90% and cerebrovascular disease more than 50% time. So patients with peripheral arterial disease, they will die of coronary artery disease. So patients with peripheral arterial disease have a 6-fold increased risk of cardiovascular disease mortality compared to patients without peripheral arterial disease in diabetic patients. So patients, anybody is having peripheral arterial disease, we need regular evaluation of their cardiac status and as well as sugar status. You can see this a patient, when a patient with a toe gangrene, without evaluating the blood circulation, if you amputate the toe, and patient then toe amputation site did not heal, then below knee amputation, that time a patient came to me and I found out that patient is having auto-iliac disease. Here, without improving the blood circulation, if we'll amputate the leg, then this will be the condition. So we have to improve the blood circulation and amputation. If there is sepsis, straight away we should go for amputation. So this is the natural history. You can see here, all we are worried for the infectious disease, but atherothrombosis is very high in the society as well as in the globally. And because today's scenario is the COVID scenario, hypercoagulable state is happening. So many patients, they are coming with toe gangrene or with stroke. So because of hypercoagulable state, so those patients with the COVID positive, we are giving anticoagulation prophylaxis. In spite of that, also few patients are coming with gangrene. There we are doing thrombolysis or thromboembolectomy. So goal of treating the patient with peripheral arterial disease is relief of symptom, improve quality of life, limb salvage, followed by prolonged survival. So the most important is risk factor modification and improve lower limb circulation. So improve lifestyle modification, all we know, diet and weight control, exercise, hypertension, diabetes control, lipid control, and smoking or tobacco cessation, any form of tobacco. So these are like endovascular and different bypass surgeries. Day by day, endovascular procedures are increasing, but patient selection is very important. Whenever having only tibial vessel disease, there along with medical therapy, we can give balloon angioplasty and short segment of femoral artery or iliac artery occlusion, we can do angioplasty stenting. Long segment occlusion, we can do bypass surgeries. You can see balloon after balloon angioplasty in the tibial vessels, how it has opened up nicely. It's the auto-iliac occlusion. After putting a stent graft in the distal aorta, the both the iliac artery, now it is visible. Pulses on table is palpable. This is an aneurysm patient. So coming to surgical bypasses, so we can do femoropopliteal bypass or femorodistal bypass. This is a small video. This is a patient, is a 55-year-old. Old diabetic patient, 7 years, last 1 year, his claudication pain has increased and ABI, both the sides, it was 0.5 and CT angio showed that both side femoral artery block. So this is the finding, both the side. So because of the bilateral femoropopliteal block, so we could not find a sufficient length of great saphenous vein. So here we have added the radial artery as a part of the bypass graft, apart from the great saphenous vein, reverse saphenous vein graft. So how we do anastomosis, you can see here. You can see the flow pressure. So that means that our proximal anastomosis is good, and it is our long graft is not any twisting is there, the flow pressure is good. So after anastomosis, you can see, so nicely the pulse palpations or visibility is very good. So that is very important. Then when we are closing, we should not apply heavy pressure in the graft, so that it has to lie on the subcutaneous plane as relaxed as possible. See here. So after procedure, the on-table pulse was palpable, and post-operative CT angio showing patent saphenofemoral vein graft, reverse saphenous vein graft. You can see here, and the ABI was more than 0.9. This is another patient where we have done thromboembolectomy. Just I want to show how is to do thromboembolectomy. This is called Fogarty catheter. What is this? The where what you are saying, the tip is there is a balloon. So how nicely the thrombus has come out. And after thrombus come out, we used to let out some blood so that we know there is no residual thrombus. You can see here how the
We are not able to see the video.
Sir, one second. So both the video you have not seen, sir?
No, we are not seen.
Okay.
I think there's some problem in video.
No, video is there. Is it visible now?
No.
Video is not coming at all.
Okay. So I'll just take out my slide. My slide is visible.
Yes. The slide is visible.
Yes. So what I will do, because slide is there, I think.
I think you have shared only the PowerPoint. Probably you have to share the video.
Yes.
Share your desktop and play the video, sir.
Yes. Yes. Now I got it.
Now got it now? Yeah.
Yes. Is it visible now? No.
No, sir, we can't see.
Your screen.
Please share your
screen. Yes. I'll share screen, iPhone, iPad, Zoom. Yes. Share. Yes.
Now you can play.
Yes. So this is a patient, as I told, it is a 55-year-old diabetic male where the 7 years before we did auto-bifemoral bypass and claudication pain developed again. If you see both the legs, femoropopliteal long segment block is there. So here we thought we cannot go ahead with the balloon angioplasty because it's more than 15 centimeter size, around 20 centimeter. So we thought put a femoropopliteal bypass graft, but the vein was good, but the because it was both legs simultaneously, so we thought to use the radial artery simultaneously along with the great saphenous vein graft. So you can see after proximal anastomosis.
We are not able to see the video again. You are not able to see the video, sir.
You have seen zero till now?
No, we can't see yet. We haven't opened it. Okay. Just we have only seen this.
You please click
now. I think
can play.
You need to click that.
Is it visible now?
No, it's just opening now, and I think we need to wait for a minute.
Now it has opened?
No, sir.
Okay.
Sir, you have to share your desktop, sir. I think you are sharing only the folder file.
You open that one, then you press over this air screen. I think that will come.
Share screen, enter your desktop. There will be a desktop option. You have to stop now and share again.
Yeah. So here, stop share. So now,
you play that video.
Yes.
Screen share.
Yes.
Yeah.
Is it visible?
Now it is visible, but not video. It's only.
I'll start. As already I told, if you see, outer bifemoral graft is nicely visible, and both the femoral arteries SFA from origin it has blocked. Both the side. So is it visible?
Yes.
Yeah, very good. So you can see the proximal anastomosis is over, and it's nicely, the graft is pulsating nicely. So now, because the length was small, so we anastomose the radial artery, and after anastomosis, you can see here, how is the flow? Already I told, you can see the flow. You see the flow pressure. So by that we know there is no twisting of the our graft, and as well as flow pressure is good. So then similarly, we did both sides at a time. And after the procedure, you can see the how nicely the graft is lying relaxedly. There should not be any tension in the graft, and we used to see nice visible pulse, and we check the distal pulses also on table, and dorsal ispidus, posterior tibial, both are palpable. So the case selection is very important, where you will get the result and the patient will get the result. And after finishing 2 weeks post-op, ABI was 0.9, and we did a CT peripheral angio, which showed nice both the sides graft are nicely patent. And similarly, is it visible, the embolectomy, my screen now?
No.
Okay.
Yes.
Is it visible?
Yes.
Yeah. So how we do, why I showed this video, to show all our colleagues as well as our students that how we do thromboembolectomy. So this is the Fogarty catheter, and in the Fogarty catheter tip, you'll see there is a balloon. So different sizes are there. This is number 4 Fogarty catheter. You can see here. So the tip of the balloon, as per the size, the balloon size varies. So depending on the which vessel we are going to do thromboembolectomy, that size we decide. And you see nicely the thrombus has come out. So whether it has come out or any residual thrombus is there or not, we used to let out some blood so that we'll know there is a flow pressure is good. There is no residual thrombus is there. So thank you, sir. And I'll be very happy for any questions if you are having, sir.
So we'd like to know, what is the emergency management of acute diabetic foot? Dr. Nihar and Dr. Sinha.
Yes, sir. Actually, sir, acute diabetic foot, many times they don't come in time. And they think that we'll buy some time, and now they are all showing the COVID scenario. Patients are coming with maggots. So imagine, why? That means that their son or daughter, IT people, they are there at home, but they are not looking out the dressing when the person at home they are doing. So thing is, and they are not doing regularly. So any patient with acute diabetic foot, we have to see what is his sugar status. We have to control the blood sugar status, and as well as what is the cause of the diabetic foot. The blood circulation is good or not. If it is blood circulation is not good, we have to evaluate where is the block. And if it is only simple peripheral neuropathy, apart from the control of the wound sepsis, we have to give a proper offloading suit, Professor Hutta told.
My observation, among the three settings in diabetic foot, vascular, infective, and neurogenic, which is the most problematic to manage?
I will tell that my department, sir. Because they come to me, if yearly, then I can give the result. Yesterday, one patient I sent to Dr. Srinivas, the patient, uncontrolled diabetes, daughter is a dentist, and because of a patient from Nalgonda, because daughter is there, she was pestering the father, please control and go to a doctor. So we did bypass surgery of one leg. That leg is fine. Again, he restarted with smoking habit and uncontrolled diabetes, landed up in gangrene of the other leg. So Dr. Srinivas did some wound, that means sepsis control. Then I did bypass surgery. Then at present, patient was fine last 1.5 years.